Next, I would like to call on the stage Professor Vandvik, and he's an assistant professor at the University of Oslo, and he has been developing an innovative approach to get evidence to inform clinicians on practice as well as patients everywhere, anywhere, or anywhere, anytime, and on all devices. He has a wide international collaboration to develop a digital and trustworthy ecosystem. And he's been working on what we know as the Magic App Project and WikiLeaks, not WikiLeaks. So I would like to invite him now to show us the magic.
Thank you. Can you hear me? So it's a great pleasure to be here. Thanks so much for inviting me to talk about this topic. I'm going to draw a pretty big and vicious picture during this presentation, what we call digital and trustworthy evidence ecosystem to increase value and reduce waste in healthcare. Whether that's a fact or fiction, I hope will become clear through my presentation. And the vision we have behind this project is that we really want people involved in evidence, each step of this ecosystem, to start working together, get out of their silos, and use technology to actually let the evidence flow from its production to its synthesis and systematic use to guidelines, to tools for decision support, implementation in the HR, followed by evaluation and improvement in healthcare, in a loop. So I want to start off with a quick raise of hands. How many here in the audience is involved in evidence production, so doing trials and research, hands up? Thank you. Evidence synthesis, doing systematic use, patient data reports. Evidence dissemination, doing guidelines, tools for decision support. Evidence implementation, decision support systems in the HR. So we got actually all the actors in place, and the question is how do we link us together in this evidence ecosystem? I'll declare that I might have some potential academic interests, potential conflict of interest. I'm head of Vandvik, and you'll hear more about Vandvik very soon. I'm a board of trustees member. I'm also co-chair for the scientific committee, the Global Evidence Summit. Trish tweeted that I'm excessively evidence-focused and epistemologically naive in a recent interaction. That might be a conflict. And actually, I'm going to show one of her papers from it's called Evidence-Based Medicine in the Moving Crisis. It's one of the most dedicated papers in the NDA a couple of years ago. It was followed by other papers saying that we actually should enter the post-guidelines era in healthcare. And we actually need to make evidence-based medicine work for individual patients. Other papers call for shared decision-making tools. And I've gone through all these papers and I've summarized the critique in the following ones. And I agree we do have major limitations with EDM and guidelines. So for developers, we struggle to make them trustworthy. We might ignore other sources of knowledge, which is very nicely highlighted in the paper yesterday. And it's extremely resource demanding to create update guidelines to extreme duplication of efforts across the world. We are several hundred groups looking at the same evidence at the same time, creating recommendations, all working in our silos. For the end users, clinicians and patients, to what extent are the recommendations available, useful, considered actually also understandable at the point of care? Could we actually not finally allow shared and personalized decisions with individual patients? How do we keep them up to date? And could we actually, as Kevin pointed out, get them all the way into the HR, link the patient data to individualize decisions? These are major challenges that I am meeting. Question is about time to respond to the calls from the opponents and provide some solutions. And I think one of the things many of these opponents ignore and don't cite in their work is the major advances we actually have made in standards, methods, and tools for EDM and guidelines. It's much more easy for us to search and identify this current evidence, to trace it, synthesize it, disseminate it, and this is the user's guide to medical literature, my favorite textbook, or guidance, my mentor, up here or up there. analysis. On the front page, there are tools where you can now discuss with your patient on a tablet, for instance, benefits and harms, practical issues related to treatment alternatives, to do share decision. The DIN standards and IOM standards for the guidelines, the great system, all these are great advances. Now, to what extent can technology help us? That's the focus of this last session. And again, there are platforms and tools to use. I'm going to show you Vandvik and the model we have provided when we created this tool. So this is a guideline authoring and publication platform. And the idea is that guideline maps go online, create guideline content structure in a database, and then if you do this, for instance, by creating PICO questions that are structured, evidence profiles, global benefits and harms, natural numbers, recommendations, you automatically publish on all devices, like Patrick pointed out, in a new multi-layer format. And we've done a lot of work in the site project, the great work to do research on what should these formats look like for you as a clinician, so that you actually can find recommendations first and build up and find everything you want. We have from day one worked on how to integrate recommendations and evidence in the EHR with the patient data. If you have the content in this database, it's much more easy to adapt individual recommendations and then reuse what others have done and increase efficiency. And then we have our decision aids where you can create discussions and consultations. Finally, this tool allows a living guideline to be created because you just go in and enter new information, evidence, and change that particular recommendation in the living guideline format. So I'll show you examples of how this looks like afterwards. Everybody can go to the Vandvik.org website and see all the published guidelines. Now, this is not enough. This is just like halfway. And the major challenge is we recognized a couple of years ago that we also have to solve for weighting our guidelines. So this series is an asset, increasing value and using waste and research, which shows that we need more relevant evidence and higher quality. So the question is, do evidence producers in this room answer the needs of patients in society using the right methods to provide high quality evidence? That's one challenge. Now, how about those implementing evidence, evaluating and improving care? How do we close the gap between best current evidence and delivered care? Now, I met the improvers, and I was in the improvement work, and I was at a conference in Paris, beautiful city of Paris, 2014. Huge, great conference, I don't know, 5,000 people, and I became a little bit depressed because there was no talk about EBM or guidelines. How could that be? Then, this conference last week in Silicon Valley, in e-health, it's a blooming industry. Again, I couldn't find any presentation, and I think there were more than 200 presentations, nothing in guidelines and evidence-based medicine, which is, I am excessively evidence-focused, as I can imagine. Dr. Watson might be a great help, but this paper in Nature last year from our colleague Julian Elliott highlights what has been signaled here in the plenary sessions. How do we make sense of those data? So, we are not lost, do not despair. We have some great people in our community that work over the last 3 years to actually figure out some really key challenges in terms of technology. And what I'm going to show you in the MC is based on the work by GeneTech, Cochrane Tech, Brain Tech. The basics about people that actually want to work together and agree on how to structure data across the different stages of the ecosystem. So you got Julian Elliott, the guy who means confidence platform. Gabriel Rada is the Mummy Code. Jan Brosek, who's doing another stream, Rave Pro DDT. Chris Malagames, the group from Cochrane. Ilka Kudanur, a visionary GP from Finland, having done a decision support in the EBM tools in Finland, and then Brian Alper and Diamond. Other people have worked hard last year to agree on how to actually make the evidence flow to what we call the evidence ecosystem. And in the middle, of course, Lily Grant, the mastermind of Magica. She will never give up before we have this in place. So, this is our issue. We want to get away from those silos of evidence producers doing their research. the middle, we have what we call a peak or linked data model based on work by my colleagues, which should allow evidence to flow from its creation, either from trials or studies, or even big data. That would be great to go synthesizing evidence. It should take 6 to 12 months, it should take 1 to 2 months, followed by guideline creation, decision support tools over the next month, all the way into the HR for personalized decision support. And then finally, closing the loop, what Kevin alluded to, how do we make this learning system so that we actually generate new, higher quality, more relevant evidence that feeds into the loop, improves our guidelines, and the trustworthiness of our recommendations. This is pretty ambitious. We realize this is ambitious. But we really want to do this. We think we are seeing that this is an emerging need system on television, patient stories about we actually are moving forward with this. While we started working on this, and I've been working with Guideline conversations, I'm a proud member of the Digital Board of Trustees for 7, 8 years. And I think organizations have some major challenges to overcome. Talking about politics, changing leadership, bureaucracy, and the fact that we now actually have to start working in digital formats. So we thought 2 years ago, how could we get potentially practice-changing evidence into practice more rapidly? And we said, why don't we just get the best people? There are so many great people in the room here and all over the world who knows how to do guidelines, methodologists, clinicians, patient representatives. Why don't we just get them together and get the work done? And then we said, oh, yeah, we can do this. We have a platform like Vandvik. Don't we have a platform like Vandvik? So how do we globally disseminate this evidence? So then we thought, why don't we go to a journal, a medical journal? And they can publish recommendations in a new format, link to this platform, and make this available. And this is to speed up the whole evidence ecosystem. It's to speed up this particular part of the ecosystem, at least solving that problem. So we now have established what's called the BMA Rapid Rex project. We just published yesterday our first publication. I'll show you in a minute. But the idea is we have this network of people, a guideline panel. We focus heavily obviously on trustworthy guideline standards and grade. We have a big focus on conflict of interest and patient involvement. Lula sitting here raised her hand. She's happy to be part of better enrolled patients in all our efforts. And then we do, if we need to, link high quality system values. So for our first one, we did both effects, prognosis, and milestone preferences, and we did so in a month. And these are separate teams, but they work really closely together. From day one, the system value team interacts with the guideline panel, so the guideline panel will get exactly what they need to create recommendations. The process we developed, and all this is available in the publications I'll show you in a minute. We monitor the evidence through McMaster Plus. It's a great service. We get an email once there's a study that could change practice. We set up a team within a week. We do the system review within a month. And then we submit recommendations, system reviews, evidence summaries, decision dates for peer review in the journal, BJ, at day 60. Then we publish. At day 90, that's our target. So how does this look like? I'm going to give you a case. This is a patient in Oslo. I call him Danielle. The picture is from Google. Signed 69 years old. He's got heart failure, not feeling well. And he's got something called severe aortic stenosis and narrowing of the heart valve. He's set up for open heart surgery. This is our recent newspapers. This was back in May. And he questions my colleague whether he can have this fancy new procedure called TAVI. It's a transcatheter aortic valve implantation, which he thinks sounds pretty neat compared to open heart surgery. And indeed, this trial called Partner 2, published in the New England Journal of Medicine late April, was captured by our team, and we thought immediately this trial would really change practice for patients at low to intermediate risk of dying from surgery. So this is our process, and this is the output from all the hard work we've done that I'll show you in the BMJ. And we would love your feedback on how this looks. If I'm able to get it up on the screen. So the BMJ wants to innovate their way to publish evidence to clinicians. So they use something called infographics. And I'll scroll down and show you how they would like to present recommendations to their readers, to the clinicians, doctors in this case. And it basically shows you what this solution is used, poly or soft, which is a surgery. You will see we made several recommendations. They're based on age. I'm going to have a look at those between 75 and 84, or actually 65 to 74, because Danielle was 69. Then they can click and they will get to the benefits and harms, which is basically some refined table you can grade in a different format. And then you can read short statements about preferences and values, resources, other considerations. And if you want to, you can go all the way to Vandvik. We highlight the surgeries, which is in this case that we don't know how long these timing marks last, which really drove recommendations to be conservative, even though there is a benefit of this in treatment. Now, let's have a look at the magic app. You will click, and you will find what I call the motivated presentation formats. Again, developed through the site project. Scroll down, find recommendations first. Now, if I really want to know more about the underlying evidence, perhaps I want to engage in shared decision-making with the data. You can find short statements about benefits and harms, qualitative evidence, preferences and values, resources, but you can also find a full some refined table, using grade. You can see that for this guy, 1,000 patients like Daniel, you have 90 fewer dying over next year, and stroke, with 14 fewer. Then you can scroll down and you can actually see that quite many patients would actually risk having a new valve over the next 10 years. So these are the actual effects and the quality of evidence associated with those anticipated outcome effects. So this is the way we now present recommendations and the justification, why did we end up with this recommendation, stated here, references, if you want to drill back and read the papers, and this is our decision makers. And these decision aids were made to create discussions based on the model developed by Victor Montoria and their clinic. And it's all about creating discussions to allow shared decision making. So then we switch to the mode where we don't really care about the recommendation anymore. There's a lot of issues to consider that the panel thought was important to make this decision. We know, for instance, that patients would be very occupied with what does this mean for me, some practical issues, recovery time. You might want to go there and look at this particular treatment choice. You can also look at mortality and you just visualize the effect just on the some refined table, a little more easy to understand formats. So you end up with having some cards, some benefits and some harms, and then enter a discussion about what's best for you. These tools will be developed, research, we need to now know how they work in practice. It would be great if you could try them, give us feedback, and everything. Okay, so that's the BMJ Rankings. And then, moving forward in the evidence review system. Oops. All this is open access. We really would like you to adapt and make use of this instead of duplicating efforts and tell us what we can do better. So, I'm going to close off by showing you actually how we can make the whole evidence review system work if we have all the actors in place. In Belgium and Finland, we actually do. So, this is Bad Packets, he's the founder of EBM in Aragon. In Belgium, this is Daniel and Paul, who actually pull all the actors together, and this is Luca Camino. So I'm going to give you an example, and in this case, it's actually more ignored evidence than new evidence. It's the use of probiotics for children taking antibiotics. We were in Belgium in June, working on the system, and told the GPs there about this, and they said, hey, we didn't know about this. We need to change back. So let's see how this could work. Well, in this case, there are 20 trials, 4,000 children, great conferences that we published recently. If you treat 10 children with probiotics, you reduce, you avoid diarrhea, even severe diarrhea, proceeding to physical infection. So we're piloting a quick UX, a rapid UX project, showing them how to do this. This is really similar, it's also here today, Gordon, and they gathered a panel, creating a strong recommendation to children between 0 and 2 years of age to be offered probiotics. We have our decision aids, but then how do we link this to the next steps and actually implement, validate, and improve care? Well, we have structured the HR in these settings. We can link plug-in recommendations straight in. And they have a system to measure performance already. So they can tell us that only 300 children were offered probiotics in their practices right now. A little bit more detail on how we do this. Okay, so we have the recommendations set in the summaries, decision aids in Vandvik, in Magic app, plugged into the up-to-date equivalent in Finland and Belgium, the guidelines. There you can see the same recommendations in the textbook. You can click on back to Magic app if you want. But in this case, it went to Belgium for translation, and we have automated translation services. IBS is in the room today. Great service to the automated translation into 5 languages in this case. Adaptation wasn't necessary, so we could then create a decision support. This is the EDM immense engine where you create a script and provide in this case a reminder. This is a GP in Belgium who had a patient 2 weeks ago called Stella Adroit. It's not a real name, she's from London. 17 months old, she got pneumonia, and she was prescribed antibiotics again by this doctor. Now, when she prescribed antibiotics in the HR, she finds amoxicillin, which is a recommended treatment, but then she gets this reminder up to the right, and this means that she will get to the evidence if she wants. She can drill back and see all the evidence, but in this case, she looked at the reminder, it's one click to prescribe probiotics for this patient. And this allows her to actually then also go back and look at the evidence because this is new to her. But she can then, if she agrees, act on the evidence, offer in this case the prescription, patient information leaflet to the mother, this beautiful little baby, and then they can go and in this case buy probiotics and antibiotics to the local pharmacy. Same goes for Finland, it's all in place. So it's possible actually to implement the ecosystem if you do have that access in place, and this is what we really want to see happening over the next year. Remaining challenges are many, and unmet needs in the ecosystem relates, I think, to the large extent of what you mentioned, Kevin. So what about this step? Well, if you do have structured EHRs, why don't we do the trials and the research in the EHRs, clinical systems, add-on applications, patient-dependent data, and then to feed into the system. And this is actually not entirely fixed either, because they did some nice trials, registry-based randomized trials in the EHR. This is a TACE trial from Sweden, where they showed that this is possible. So, in summary, I think it's fair to say we do have made major advances in our methods, standards, systems, tools in what seems to be an emerging evidence ecosystem in healthcare. It's all about people. Definitely the most important that we have a culture for sharing the work and the data and common understanding of research methods, which is why we want to engage with the medical informatics society so we can learn from each other. Technology, also crucial, all these platforms are now becoming linked. The company is a great partner, they really want to make this happen quite fast. And then you should not think about RapidX as us trying to take over the world. We don't want to do this with my use. We don't want to do the recommendations. So if you guys can pull this off, disseminate to the world, allow adaptation and use that point of care, we're happy to shut down. It's a model. Questions, will organizations get the work done, or do we need what I call disruptive innovation? Like in other sectors, we have collaborative networks and platforms to share the work, and I think this is a challenge for Jim and